Sometimes I forget that I've done so many things, you know, they sort of slip by. But yeah, I did a radio play on Maud Gunn many years ago, many, many years ago, who was the muse of William Butler Yeats, and she was a woman who was the first woman in the IRA. And I think this was like, whatever, anyway, won a national award, so I've always been thrilled with that because I like these strong women that get out there, yeah. Anyway, today I'm here to talk about Eugene Ionesco, as you all know. I was blessed to meet and interview Monsieur Ionesco when he was doing some talks at USC, and we began a sort of a correspondence. I think he liked me, and he liked women in particular, so his wife never left him alone with a woman any place, even if it was an interview. And I found him just amazing, amazing human being. I'm going to read, you probably all know this, but I said, started out, this theater in England, I think England, just did a play of his that they've done, and then they asked me to contribute a piece on him. So this was somebody who's still listening, reading, and going to see Ionesco, because this was about 2 years ago. But here in this country, we don't have anything like that anymore. So I'll just read a little introduction. He was born in Romania, and after studying French literature at the University of Bucharest, he settled in Paris in 1938, when he received a government grant to write a thesis on, quote, sin and death in French poetry since Baudelaire, an apt subject for him. He was a fervent believer in human rights and a long-standing enemy of political tyranny. He campaigned for many years in exile against the authoritarian regime of Romanian dictator Nicolae Ceausescu, who banned his plays in Romania. As you probably all know, his plays were staged all over the world during the 60s and 70s and were among the most performed works in the theatrical repertoire at that time. With his plays, The Bald Soprano and The Lesson and The Chairs, he helped to inaugurate a new type of theater which came to be known as the theater of the absurd. Actually, it was the critic Martin Esselin that named the theater of absurd. This theater included Samuel Beckett, Jean Genet, and Arthur Adamoff, and was a theater that posed a problem. It was not a theater of entertainment. The problems they dealt with were the existential condition of man, his despair, the tragedy of his destiny, the ridiculousness of his destiny, the absurdity of his destiny, and the existence of God. When asked by a New York Times journalist in 1988 to list his compatriots in the theater of the absurd, Ionesco named Beckett, Genet, Adamoff, and Shakespeare. Shakespeare, the interviewer asked, and this is a great quote, Ionesco responded, Shakespeare is the king of the theater of the absurd. Macbeth, for example, says that the world is a tale told by an idiot full of sound and fury, signifying nothing. That is the pure definition, he went on, of the theater of the absurd, and perhaps of the world. Shakespeare was the great one before us. His place was between God and despair. Another interesting problem is the existence of God, a divinity, as Beckett writes about in Waiting for Godot. Man without God, without the metaphysical, without transcendence, is lost, is what he wrote. And then, not surprisingly, Ionesco went on to criticize American realistic and naturalistic theater as naive and simple-minded, which we can certainly say a lot of that is what we have now. Ionesco's work is characteristically combines dream or nightmare atmosphere with grotesque, bizarre, and whimsical humor. His first play, Bald Soprano, which was written in 1950, satirizes the deadness of bourgeois society, frozen in meaningless formalities. Ionesco referred to his plays as anti-plays. It was Martin Esselin, as I said before, who dubbed the work Theater of the Absurd. Amadei in 1954 was Ionesco's first three-act play. It portrays the lonely, bitter life of a couple who share their apartment with a corpse, a symbol of their dead love. As the play progresses, the corpse grows to gigantic proportions. Ionesco subsequently created a character named Beranger, a simple sort of everyman, who is also a self-image of himself. Beranger appears in five of his plays, including the classic Rhinoceros, which was in 1959, and Exit the King, 1962. In Rhinoceros, his breakthrough play in English, Totalitarianism, in which he meant Nazism and Fascism, is depicted as a disease that turns human beings into savage rhinoceroses. The hero, Beranger, stands alone, watching as his friends turn into horned beasts. In Exit the King, the by now 400-year-old King Beranger confronts and comes to terms with his own death. Some of the dialogue includes various characters saying that at the beginning of his regime, the population was 9,000 million. Now there are only 1,000 old people, and they are all dying as we speak. In an article he wrote for the USC Chronicle, which is where I met him on the occasion of his talks there in 1980, it was a symposium in honor and celebration of his work at USC, and he gave an opening talk. The following are a few excerpts of that talk. "Culture cannot be separated from politics," he said. "The art and philosophy and metaphysics, religion, and the sciences constitute culture. Politics are the science or art of organizing our relationships to allow for the development of life in society. But within our time, politics have overtaken all other manifestations of the human spirit. Development and developing as they have by trampling on man's other activities, they have made men mad. Politics have become nothing more than a senseless struggle for power that mobilizes and monopolizes all the energies of modern man. We know very well that Western humanism is bankrupt. We also know very well that the leaders of the Eastern countries no longer believe in Marxism. Absolute cynicism, and this is in 1980 that he's saying these things, absolute cynicism and a great biological vitality are all that remain of the East's revolutionary faith and all that keeps its leaders in power. It keeps its leaders in power active in the struggle for power and world supremacy. Life has become, then, a deadly combat without scruple, since all ideologies and moralities have vanished. A combat for the conquest of the planet and its material riches is what remains." At the end of this talk, he refers to one of Dostoevsky's characters who says that if God does not exist, then all is permissible. Therefore, Ionesco writes, "We are now in search of permanent foundations of behavior that will once again moralize politics. The crisis is fundamental. It's a quest of human survival, and humanity survives only through culture. And culture is the expression of our continuity and of our multi-secular identity across time and space." He continues saying that culture is learned behavior and is transmitted by members of a given society to its offsprings through the medium of artistic, scientific, religious, and philosophical traditions, political and technical customs, and the thousand mores that characterize daily life. For Ionesco, politics For Ionesco, politics cannot lie. Art, true art, cannot lie, because he sees politics as a form of art. "The politics separate men by bringing them together only superficially. Art and culture unite us in a common anguish that is our only possible fraternity, that of our existential and metaphysical community." And the following is just a little bit of a conversation with him that was published after all these years in this Theater Royal Bath in the Ustinov studio in 2014. Somehow they found this piece of mine, and they have run an excerpt in it in the program note for their Exit the King production, which thrilled me, I can tell you. An excerpt from a conversation with Eugene Ionesco. The following conversation took place in May 1980 at the University of California, where he was being honored in a three-day symposium that was devoted to him and his work. An excerpt of this interview was originally published by the Canadian Theatre Review in 1981. They prefaced the interview writing, "Romanian-French playwright Eugene Ionesco, has not granted many interviews in the course of his long and distinguished career. An extended interview with him is therefore considerable significance. CTR is thereafter pleased to be able to announce the following interview being published and done by Barbara Kraft for National Public Radio in the United States. Edited for reasons of space, it was conducted this last pass during an international colloquium on Ionesco's work at the USC in California. It appears for the first time anywhere here. So I'm saying to him, there is an old saying that fame always comes for the wrong reasons, or if you think your audience understands your work and salutes you with knowledge of what you're doing already. It's a very complex problem, he answered. Commentators of writers' works generally express their own problems and their own obsessions through analyzing the work of a writer. And what concerns my work, my first plays were very favorably commented on by the leftist critics and strongly criticized by the rightist critics. The critics of the left, thinking that my plays were basically a criticism and satire of the bourgeois, therefore liked my works, and that's the basic reason why the critics of the right did not like them at all. When the critics from the left noted that my works don't deal at all with the particular satire of the little bourgeoisie, they also stopped liking my works. For that same reason, the critics of the right started liking my works more and more. In reality, to say the truth, left and right are not any more points of view valid for any criticism. There's no meaning of being at the extreme right or extreme left. These concepts have no meaning anymore. And what concerns the silent majority or the applauding majority, I have not really investigated on which side the majority is. But I think the audiences have started some time ago already understanding my plays and liking them. I have drawn great audiences. They understand my language. It is a very clear language and a very primal language and a very visual language. Only sclerotic bourgeois mentalities or other people restricted by their own ideologies have thought at the beginning that this was a theater written only for a limited audience. So when my first play started to be performed all over the world, I think the audiences who were not dependent on specific ideologies, who were open to new trends in theater, they received very favorably my plays in the world. My plays have been performed before children, workers, and peasants, and they're well understood the meaning of my theater. What is needed for people to watch my theater is a freshness and openness of mind. They must go to this theater without any prejudice. Nevertheless, it could be said that my plays are criticisms of kinds and forms of mental sclerosis. Any good work of art should also be critical. What's interesting is Henry Miller was a very close friend of mine at that time before his death. I've been fortunate in my life to have had relationships with Anais Nin, Henry Miller, and Ionesco, all quite came by things that I had written and published, and I wrote a piece on, well, Anais did the preface to my first book, which brought down my marriage, but that was meant to be and was not a bad thing. And then I met Henry. I wrote a piece on Henry for the Hudson Review, and someone took it to him, and I had a call from the household saying he wanted to meet me. And so that's how I met Henry, and then I became one of his cooks for the last year and a half or 2 years of his life. He had people coming in to cook dinner for him. He lived alone. Tony, his son, was there for a while with him, and then Tony left. Henry was alone, so he had different people coming in every night to cook for him. And so I would go once a week, sometimes once every other week, and we'd have great conversations, and it was a lot of fun. And my book on, wherever it is, Henry Miller, charts all of that. And Ionesco was very interested in meeting Henry. But Henry demurred because he said he didn't want Ionesco to see him how he was now. And he was failing badly at this time, you know, he wouldn't have to. And towards the end, I was one of the only one or two of the cooks that, you know, could kind of deal with this. So, but he was great. And so Ionesco then Henry sent a bunch of books to Ionesco through me. And that's how that happened. And what else was it with Ionesco that I was going to tell you? I'm trying to think now, it slipped my mind. Well, anyway, it was this business of not wanting Ionesco to see him because of the condition that he was in that was so touching. And so I stayed in touch with Mazzieri and Ionesco through the mail and certainly had an invitation to go to him in Paris. I never managed to do that. But I enjoyed very much knowing him. It was a very special experience in my life. And he has a couple of quotes that I liked so much that I always keep, actually I have them taped to my bathroom window because I like to see them in the morning. He says, one of the things he said is, love is a state of grace. And I think that's so beautiful and I think it's true. And then another, which must have come later in his life, said, above all, one must not let oneself disintegrate. One must endure and keep on living. And so there comes a point in life where we all think that that is something that is nice to hold on to, I think. And he said also, there were a couple of other things that I like very much that he said, ideology separate us, and dreams and anguish bring us together. And then he said also, there is no humor, where there is no humor, there is no humanity. Where there is no humor, there is a concentration camp. And then the last thing that I'll quote from him is that, to discover the fundamental problem common to all mankind, I must ask myself what my fundamental problem is, what my most inner fear is. I am certain then to find the problems and fears of literally everyone. That is the true road into my own darkness, our darkness, which I try to bring to the light of day. When we escape from definitions, we will breathe again. So that was Mr. Ionesco, and do you have any questions or comments? Yes?
Tell us a little bit about his private life. Did he have children?
Ionesco? No. And he didn't have children. And his wife was a little tiny woman. He was rather robust. And did I say this great story about him taking the chair out? Okay, so when the Six-Day War happened in Israel, he took his chair out in whatever, I can never say that, in one of the streets of Paris, and sat there and cried in the middle of the day and wept. And you know, you can't do that kind of thing in America. Even in the 60s, you couldn't do that kind of thing.
Was he Jewish?
I don't know whether he, no, he wasn't, but he was so appalled by it. So that's, you know, he took the chair out and just sat there and just cried. And it was very touching to hear that.
When did he die?
You know, I don't know for sure.
87?
Let's see if I have a date. I always think of him as being so alive. Yeah, no, I
think.
I have to look it up.
What?
I'll look it up.
Oh, good.
I have to look it up. Okay. Did you have a letter from him? I forgot.
Oh, yes, and I meant to bring it, and I forgot. I have a wonderful letter that he wrote me when Henry died, and I think I have it here. Thank you for reminding me that. When Miller died, when Miller died, he did write me the following letter. The translation is not as good as it should be. He says, dear friend, we have returned to France since 2 weeks, and since then we have been turned upside down by many things which have not permitted us to write to you sooner. The death of Henry Miller touched us very much. We have known the publisher house of Boucher Chastel, the editors. We want to thank you for the books which you brought to us in Los Angeles. Transit, these were Henry's books, Transit and the Book of Friends. Often in Transit, he makes many times mention of my works. There is about, I couldn't translate this, a month when I was signing books in Southern California, and a student brought me a book, and page written on it was Anais Nin, Ionesco, Go Ionesco, signed Henry Miller. So I guess Henry had signed one of those books for Ionesco. And then to go on, Miller writes something about having been here 2 years earlier in the same hotel that he met me in. Something Henry wanting to come with someone to drive him, but it never happened because his caretaker told Ionesco, this is bad translation, but told Ionesco that Miller was too ill. Then he writes that they didn't rate Henry Miller and now it is too late. He felt Ionesco didn't rate Henry Miller, and then it was too late. I would like to know the interview that we made is published, and if yes, send me a sample. And we embrace you and hope to meet you in Paris, in Los Angeles. We like very much your study of Henry Miller that was published here. So I guess it was published in Europe as well. And Ionesco was just an amazing experience to meet him, you know. Yes.
Where was his home base?
Oh, who? Mm-hmm. Ionesco?
In Paris.
Yeah.
And was he related to another person of the same name but different spelling?
Not to my knowledge.
The composer?
I don't think so. You think it's...
George Ionesco.
Yeah, yeah.
It's different spelling.
A different E with an E. It is, isn't it? Yeah, yeah.
They were not related?
No, they weren't related, no. Are you a musician?
No.
No, okay.
He passed away in 1994.
Oh, okay, 1994.
Nearly 100
times. When did he leave Romania?
He left Romania, I think I started this out with, did I get the year? I thought I gave the year. He left it I think it was 1933 or something, or maybe he was born then. He left very early because he got a fellowship to write in Paris on all of those writers that...
I thought you said 38. But he
I think 38 or 36, thank you. Yeah.
He left in 38 or 36?
I'm looking.
You had said 38.
38? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, that's what, because I read that quote somewhere about when I began, that was it, and I think it's here where, wait a minute. Yes, he was born in 38. He left Bucharest and settled in Paris in 38. You're absolutely correct.
He was born in 1912.
No, you were correct.
Oh, did
I?
That?
Just quoted you.
Oh, okay, thank you. Okay. Where he received a government grant to write a thesis on sin and death in French poetry since Baudelaire, which I think is just heaven, you know. He was exiled from Romania, of course, and never. I don't think he ever went back.
He never lived directly under Ceausescu.
Yes, he did until he left for Paris.
There was no Ceausescu then.
Yeah, no, Ceausescu wasn't there.
I stayed there. Yeah. Ceausescu was a Soviet. Oh,
I'm sorry. No. Yes. Right. Right.
The Iron Guards then.
Yeah. No, this is. No, he was in exile against the authoritarian regime of Romanian dictator Ceausescu.
Yeah,
that's why he left. And he could never go back.
No.
They might not. I wonder if they have the...
I'm sorry?
He was a Soviet puppet. After the Second World War, they installed Ceausescu as a Soviet puppet of Romania.
Right. So he could never go back.
But Ionescu left before, then Ceausescu was not there. Ceausescu was a communist.
Well, it says he was. He says that here that in this little biography that he settled in Paris in 1938, and because he was. I don't know then. So what are you saying, Ceausescu?
Ceausescu was in power at that time. That sounds like they have a research error.
Right. Okay.
He settled permanently in Paris.
Yes. Yes.
1945.
Uh huh. Okay. Yes.
So during the war, he wasn't in Paris either.
You know, I don't know where. I think he was, though. I think he was writing about Paris.
He was doing his PhD also.
That's right. He was doing his PhD there. But he was also writing there.
And
but
he clearly wasn't Jewish.
He must have lived under the Vichy regime then, if he was in Paris.
Right. And I don't think he was Jewish.
He couldn't have been. He would have survived in Paris.
Yeah, no.
He would have been French.
Right.
He wasn't.
No, not at all. You know. So, I think you know more about him than I do.
No, just...
The first part of your presentation was so interesting when you were talking about the existentialism and so on. Now, that's the part I'd hope you would perhaps expand a little bit, because my understanding of existentialism is somewhat limited.
Right.
More than somewhat limited.
Well...
And I just think that was so fascinating.
Let me look.
In fact, I'd love to have a copy of those first two pages. Is that possible?
Yeah, well, why not? But we have to serve. Oh, no, you can have them because I can have them on my computer. Let's see. Where are we here? Well, he felt that Western humanism was bankrupt, as I said earlier. But I don't know where he talked about...
When we're talking about his plays.
Oh, right, 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 right. Yeah, that they were, did I use the word existentialism here?
No, you said that existential condition of man is in the theater of the absurd, yeah. And also that it also, which is what they explored, and also the question of God.
Right, right. That's when it said that Macbeth, for example, says that the world is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing, you know. And he said that's the basis, the pure definition of the theater of absurd. And so I don't know whether he did. He wasn't like radically political. It was in his works that he was political, and I think that's where the difference was.
So he was going back to God and religion because he thought that cynicism was just going to lead to nowhere. Right?
He didn't. Well, I don't think he went back to religion, but he went to this theater of absurd that he did, and he criticized, man without God, without the metaphysical, is without transcendence. That's really what he thought. That's sort of what you're saying, I think.
I think so.
Yeah, that without God, man. So he did obviously, if he had that feeling and thought that, he had to have believed in God.
I'm not quite clear on this though, because as I said, my knowledge of it is very limited. Yeah. When you talk about the idea that he wrote the theater of the absurd and all the plays he wrote, they seem rather cynical in a lot of ways.
Well, they are cynical.
And yet you're saying that with that cynicism, he then has determined that the cynicism of mankind basically is empty without God. Is that
right? I think that's
correct?
True.
Is that what
you're
saying?
I think that's true. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because I think he does believe in God underneath it all, you know? You were going to say something?
Oh, yeah, I was going to ask about, you say his plays aren't, they don't perform his plays as much.
They don't perform
today.
Them at all anymore now.
Yeah, I remember just a few years ago, because I was, you know, working with you, and they had a production in Long Beach.
Right.
I forget which play it was. But,
right.
I mean, like, I'm wondering, do you have any opinion of why maybe his plays aren't?
Because I don't think people really understand them. I think they're out of reach of people, especially in the kind of world we live in today, mm-hmm. where everything is sort of in your face and explosive. And mm-hmm. even 20 years ago, I think it was much more possible to be interested in Ionesco than anybody would today. Mm-hmm. I don't see that there's anyone, you know, I mean, except for all of us here, that mm-hmm. would be interested in Ionesco. But I've always just loved his being out there. Mm-hmm. And doing everything. And the theater here used to be, I mean, much more interesting all through, you know, up until, I don't know, maybe 2000 or something. Hmm. What's the really great theater that's now on the West Side? What is it called? I can't think of it right now. Somebody will know.
I'm not sure.
The Odyssey Theater.
I'm sorry?
The Odyssey Theater.
The Odyssey, yeah.
Twice.
Yeah, yeah.
Cheers and the Renaissance.
Yeah.
Great productions.
I'm sorry?
Great, both.
Yeah. Yeah, they did great things. But I think, you know, when he writes here that, I think this in answer to what you were saying is culture can't be separated from politics, he says, and that mm-hmm. he believes in the arts, philosophy, metaphysics, religion, and the sciences are what constitute culture. And so he was a great, to answer your question, he was a great believer in culture. And I think this is probably politics, he says, or the science of our art of organizing our relationships to allow for the development of life in society. But he says, in our time, politics have overtaken all other manifestations of the human spirit. And so I think that is somewhat an answer to what your question was. You know, he says, politics have become nothing more than a senseless struggle for power that mobilizes and monopolizes all the energies of modern man. So I think that, and he says here too, that Western humanism is bankrupt. And so he finds, I think, that and it talks about the absolute cynicism of world leaders, and that life has become then a deadly combat without scruple, since all ideologies and moralities have vanished I think that's the real answer to what you were saying. A combat for the conquest of the planet and its material riches.
That was the reason I met what you prepared. That's what I went.
Oh, okay. Oh, good. Okay.
Very interesting.
Yeah, yeah. And I think, you know, so I think, and he could be, you know, at the end of his talk, he refers to Dostoevsky's characters who say that if God does not exist, then all is permissible. Mm-hmm. So again, obviously he did believe in God. Mm-hmm. I never really thought about it that way, just because, you know, I've lived with this for so long. So it was an obvious question, but I was like grasping for the answer.
Dostoevsky also said that if there was no God, people would have invented him. Dostoevsky said that.
Said what?
There
again?
No.
What was the end? Dostoevsky said what?
That if there were no God, people would have invented him.
Oh, if, yeah. Yeah, if there are no God, people would have invented him. Yeah.
Oh, they did. Ionesco did not believe in God. Okay, he wanted to understand what else is there if there is no God. How do we become moral people? What guidance we have if there is no God? And he was in search of that foundation of what else would be there if there is no God. And that's the thing about him. And that's why it's called the cynicism as being. That's how he should be understood. Is what else in place of it if everything else is ruined? The Eastern leaders don't believe in their ideology, the Marxism, the communism, the anything
right,
else. Everything is just get rich. But what else is there to keep us from being animals? And he doesn't give us an answer.
Well, I have this quotation that I have this quotation that I have that he said, and it's to discover the fundamental problem common to all mankind, I must ask myself what my fundamental problem is, what my most ineradicable fear is. I am certain then to find the problems and fears of literally everyone. This is a true road into my own darkness, our darkness, which I try to bring to the light of day. When we escape from definitions, we will breathe again. So I think that addresses somewhat of what you're saying. He doesn't come out, you know. I have a couple of quotes here that I loved so much. I mean, I think this one also answers some of your question. I read it before, but love is a state of grace. He believed that very much. And actually, I have this on my mirror in my bathroom. And underneath it, I keep one other quote of his. Above all, one must not let oneself disintegrate. One must endure and keep on living. And I like that, those two quotes. And he's, there are a couple of others that are, ideologies separate us, dreams and anguish bring us together. Where there is no humor, there is no humanity. Where there is no humor, there is a concentration camp. That's another one of his quotes.
I don't even understand that one.
I don't either. But I do like the two, love is a state of grace, and the other about discovering.
Do you have any idea what the one about the concentration camp is written? With time?
I don't know. But it had to be, I would have to have been probably in sometime in the 60s. Or maybe later. No, wait a minute.
I was thinking maybe earlier, during
earlier,
the war.
Earlier, yeah.
Things about concentration.
Yeah, 30, mm-hmm. Yeah, earlier. Yeah. So I don't really know what he was thinking, but I really think that he was a believer in something. You know, and maybe it might not be God as we think of the term, or as people think of the term, but he certainly believed in something beyond our immediate existence, seems to me.
Well, you mentioned metaphysics. Metaphysics.
Metaphysics?
Something called parapsychics, beyond metaphysics.
Oh, okay, I don't know that. You could tell us about that. Tell us about
that. Metaphysics is kind of there's a lot. It covers a large... It covers a large territory of things, you know, you could say paranormal or ghost or things, or sometimes it's just not trying to define what people call God.
Uh-huh.
I mean, that's something I have trouble with when people say the word God. I'm interested, instantly it's personified, it's a image in my head, and rather than an experience or something that I don't want to define. I don't think I have the capacity to define. So metaphysics is kind of also a term that you could use for right. For qualities of life like that. So.
Well, since I was brought up a Catholic, I don't even think about it. Mm-hmm. It's not. It's just a given that's there, and it doesn't cause me any consternation thinking about it or not thinking about it. And I just think, yeah, I don't really think about that.
It's easier being a Catholic.
That's what some people say.
Well,
on that concentration camp, he's actually being just hearing it. I think of the irony because. Life and humans are so foible, and so if you can't laugh at human beings, there's nothing to laugh at. And it doesn't matter whether you believe in God or not. It is so actually, it's not, if you think of it metaphysically, it doesn't actually have to be a tactile concentration camp. It is a place where you would not be able to experience human
a state of mind.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so
that's a good
phrase. Part of that would be important. So he's kind of like all actually making humor of the situation.
Right. Yeah, I don't, you know, it's just funny, as I said, being brought up a Catholic, it's not something that I've ever worried about. I mean, I don't know whether there is a God or isn't a God. It just... You know, when you're brought up that way from your earliest days, you know, with the nuns and everything, it's just sort of like a given. You know, and doesn't, I mean, maybe it causes a lot of people issues.
Well,
but
yeah, I mean, because I'm raised a Catholic too.
Oh, okay, so.
12 years of Catholic school and everything,
right.
And the nuns and all that. But, you know, it's.
Yeah, but
it
you're a lot different, a lot younger, and that makes a huge difference a lot younger because
absolutely.
The world has changed so much, you know. And when you're brought up with the nuns and you know, go to Catholic college until I was thrown out.
I think when my education through that system, they allowed us to question things. That was helpful.
I don't know what the French implications of the word concentration camp are, but a camp where everyone concentrates instead of being humorous, it doesn't have to be a prison. It can be an office.
That's an interesting idea in a way of, very, very. No, I think that maybe that's exactly what he meant. It could have been.
Read the quote once more, please.
Yeah.
Slowly.
Oh. Where there is no humor, there is no humanity. Where there is no humor, there is a concentration camp.
Perfect sense to me.
Yeah.
Vivian?
Well, it seems to me, and I don't know that much about Ionesco, but besides maybe 1,000 years ago I saw a play that I can't remember, but it seems to me from hearing your talk that he's very clever, and he doesn't believe in any isms, no existentialism, no communism, no even it's not even clear whether he believes in democracy. I mean, he's just not talking in abstractions. He's against abstractions. They're worshiping whatever abstractions have been come to replace God in Western culture. But he also doesn't make clear from what you say anything. I mean, he's sort of making fun of stuff.
Yeah.
He's making fun of stuff. I mean, obviously, sadistic humor is very rampant.
Right.
Whether in concentration camps or in society today. So in some ways, I think what he says is funny, but I also think that there's another side of it when you think about how cruel humor can be. I mean, bullying and bullies are often humorous. So I think that he's grappling with a lot of stuff, and there's a lot of truth in the short things he's saying, but I don't think he builds a philosophy as much as he kind of scoffs and all those other philosophies that people have built, and he's a non-believer in those.
Well, he does talk about, you know, I mean, first of all, I found him one of the simplest human beings I have ever met. It was really, I guess I would say, pure, no matter what. I mean, if he was even on the make, there's some kind of innocence that was in him. He was obviously very sophisticated, but he was very, very simple at the same time. Very simple, but I think that he does say, let me find that quote, where he says,
Well, he talks about Beckett's writing about in Waiting for Godot, man without God, without metaphysical things, without transcendence is lost. And so, not surprisingly, he criticized the American realistic and naturalistic theater as being very naive and simple-minded. So he was certainly thinking in beyond, you know, the immediate reality of existence. And I think now that we're really thinking about this, because I haven't talked about this in a long time, or thought about it in a long time, he was also having fun with it, I think, you know, and he lived beyond norms of other people. You know, he was so unique. I've never met anybody quite as unique, you know, you know, and he did think, I think in this thing he says that, you know, culture cannot be separated, I think that's his real philosophy here, culture cannot be separated from politics. The arts, philosophy, metaphysics, religion, and the sciences constitute culture. Politics are the science or art of organizing our relationships to allow for the development of life in society. But in our time, politics have overtaken all other manifestations. So I think that's a big answer to what we're all discussing here. Developing as they have, meaning politics, they've been trampling on man's other activities that have made men mad. That politics have become nothing more than a senseless struggle for power. And then he goes on again to say that he feels that Western humanism is bankrupt. And that also he says that the Eastern countries have no more longer belief in Marxism. So where are we? And he says, life has become then a deadly combat without scruple, since all ideologies and moralities have vanished. A combat for the conquest of the planet and its material riches. And I think that's what he sees and what he believes. And he's just not a part of that. He's never been a part of any kind of organization like that. And I think that there's this incredible quality of his mind that plays with this, mm-hmm. The sleeping giant getting bigger and bigger and bigger. You mm-hmm. know that emphasizes the lack of love between he and his wife, for instance. So it's very symbolic in that way. I would think, disagree, please. If you, I'm not an expert on this. I'm just a great lover of the work and of the man that I once knew. You know,
I think rhinoceros is really one of the most interesting plays.
Hmm? Oh, rhinoceros, yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
The round ship.
Yeah, that's was you know with during the war and everything. And yeah.
So if you're going to read any one play, would it be rhinoceros?
Oh yeah, absolutely. But I also like Exile the King.
Exit the King.
Yeah, you know that. Yeah, I like that very much.
And Bold Soprano, the three. These are.
Yeah, Bold Soprano.
Can you give us a little synopsis?
I'm sorry?
Can you give us a little synopsis of each of these three plays?
I don't think I can off the top of my head. I haven't read them in so long, but Rhinoceros, I think I have in here where. Where are we here? Rhinoceros, it's... You can't read...
I would have to really study it.
I'd have to read it, reread it. I didn't reread it. I should have known that I was going to have this very educated audience. I haven't, I just know, having seen it, it was a breakthrough. I have it right here. And Rhinoceros, his breakthrough play in English, totalitarianism, and by that he's talking about Nazism and fascism, is depicted as a disease that turns human beings into savage rhinoceros. And the hero, Baron J. Stan, and he uses this Baron J. character in about five plays, stands alone watching as friends turn into horned beasts. Mm-hmm. And the rhinoceros was written in 1959. And he stands watching as his friends turn into horned beasts. And then he uses that character again now the 400-year-old King Berenger confronts and comes to terms with his own death. And some of the dialogue includes various characters saying things like, population was, at the beginning of his reign, night population was 9,000 million. Now there are only 1,000 old people, and they are dying as we speak. So, you know, he makes fun of these things. But I think that, and that this corpse, you know, which is the symbol of their dead love, gets bigger and bigger and bigger in the play we talked about before, Amadei, which was written in 54. You know, and so he, it's an incredible imagination. That when we all know when love dies, and most of us know that love does die on occasion, you know, it becomes like this weight, this storm, this stone on one. And I can see how we got it to be like this body just growing and growing in the spare room until it fills the entire room. Would you?
I don't remember the name of this particular play, but the man and the woman meet and they begin to exchange their lives. How they lived, and they have children, and all of a sudden they realize that they're husband and wife.
That one I don't recall.
I don't know the name of that one.
Right.
It's one of the earlier plays.
I should have reread all his work before doing this, because I wrote the essay on him in 1980.
I've read that.
You know, it was all fresh in my mind, every detail, and when I wrote it. But I love the plays. I read all of them, and the Odyssey Theater here used to do the plays, all of Ionesco's plays.
Yeah, a long time ago.
Yeah, but they don't do anything like that anymore.
Well, Waiting for Godot, I think, is still pretty strong. Yeah, I don't know. About a year or two ago, it's still being shown.
But
Ionesco, I don't remember. Maybe in Europe.
Maybe in Europe, yeah.
Would you revisit the relationship between Godot and Ionesco in terms of the play performance?
Well, Ionesco was definitely theater of the absurd. He went out there on a limb and made up and concocted all kinds of things. Godot was different. He was more, I would say, serious, philosophical in a way. I think Ionesco was too, but he expressed it differently.
Yeah.
Would you agree?
He was much more humorous than
than Godot.
The play is Godot, but he's more humorous than Beckett?
Than Beckett.
All of us can spread some form of humor, sense of humor.
More than Aristophanes? Or like Peace?
I know, but it's a different type of humor. It's meaningful at the same time. You have to experience that.
But, you know, it's... Where are the playwrights now, today, like that, that we could have a long conversation about?
Well, we just lost Albert. Okay.
You what?
Albert. Yeah, we just lost him. Okay, so. Yeah, so it's there.
He was certain part of this theater.
What did she say?
Yeah, it's the
theater.
Oh, Albie. Edward Albie. Oh, yeah, there was a bit. That's right, you're absolutely right. There's a big piece on him in the New York Times about a week ago.
Right.
Huge piece. You must have seen it, yeah. Yeah.
Well, I love his play, so.
Yeah, no, I agree.
How old was he? I think he's like in his 80s.
The last one is.
No.
Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf was the breakthrough play for him. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult to compare, you know. And it doesn't make sense. It seems like a Ionesco and he's all right. I mean, you can't do that. I couldn't compare it.
With Albie? No, but they're two totally different.
Albie or?
I've little come to
Okay.
I mean, I think Albie is on the same level as an Ionesco, but in a very different kind of way. I think, you know, I think he's our major playwright. Well, Tennessee Williams also, you know. Albie, Tennessee Williams.
Well, Tennessee Williams was just a realistic play.
Yeah.
So you didn't have anything to say to theater.
Yeah, but they were very gripping.
Edward Albee, well, with Tiny Alice.
Tiny Alice.
You have to really think.
Yeah, yeah. Because Tiny Alice was incredible.
And, you know, the Mark Taper used to do some of these plays at once upon a time.
There was an audience in those days. Nobody paid us to go see those anymore. Which is culture dying.
Right, right, right. Mm-hmm. Which was what Ionesco was all about.
Right.
And he made fun of it. That's what I think, you know. And I think in a way he was very childlike. You know, I know he's profound, but knowing him as a person, there was something that was so childlike about him, you know, taking the chair out in the middle of the street during, you know, the Six-Day War and sitting there crying and weeping, you know, that's...
Was there any commentary on why he did it? Was it just the concept of war? Was it about Israel? Was it
I think it was about Israel. And I don't think Ionesco was Jewish.
No. Yes, his mother was Jewish.
His ancestors were.
Oh, okay.
She was a teacher. She was a teacher in Romania. She married a non-Jewish Romanian lawyer.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. You know more about this than I do, so...
I just looked it up on the Google.
Oh, you just looked it up. Okay, thank you.
We love Google.
You heard what she said. Yeah, yeah. So that makes sense then, why he went out and sat in the street and cried. Mm-hmm. You know? And I just love that image of him. You know, and I mean, I think that... That it's interesting, some of the people to this day that really support Israel. I mean, Zubin Mehta is, you know, the conductor emeritus of the Israeli Philharmonic.
Well,
and I knew Zubin very well because my ex-husband was
in
the Philharmonic. And so I think the whole thing with Pinky Zukerman and Zubin and Danny Barenboim, you know, have been so supportive of Israel, the three of them together.
Barenboim is much more critical. Barenboim supports Palestinian rights.
He's much more critical. Well, right.
Yeah, he's against the occupation of the West Bank.
I'm sorry, what?
He's against the occupation of the West Bank.
Right, right. But the three of them were like these three gladiators together when they were younger, you know. And I feel strongly myself about Israel not giving up the West Bank. I just...
That's a different subject.
You know, I just think.
You're welcome to continue the conversation. I have to go back to the office when you're done, just let me know.
This was great, by the way. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you, Barbara.
Oh, thank you. It's always a pleasure. I think we have some more coming up sometime. We've done
please take the flyers for upcoming events, and these are books that you can check out. You just have to take them downstairs to check them out.
Yeah, I think I have to elaborate. I have to go back and elaborate on my Ionesco. I tried to, you know, get most of the high points of it, you know. And
I have a question. Yes, yeah. You said he had a character that he carried through many plays. Do you think there was a theme tying all of his plays together, or just in general? Well, I hate to say philosophy because he seems like a person who didn't like philosophy.
Well, no, but he liked serious thought very much so. And Béranger was probably kind of an alter ego for him because he went through five of his plays,
as you
point out.
Yeah. I was just wondering, like, thematically, like, if you can place the plays together and there seems to be kind of something tying them together.
A link between them, Because I think he, you know, in one sense, I think, I saw him, as I said before, as a very simple man with sort of one theme that was theater of absurd, mm-hmm. and that he saw life as that.
Life, yeah.
But he was also very profound. Mm-hmm. And it was very touching then when Miller didn't want to be seen by Ionesco.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure that you're not confusing being sensitive and being simple.
Same thing?
No, they're not the same thing.
No, they're not. No. You said sensitive.
I'm saying that he may have been more sensitive than people realized, and not necessarily
simple.
Yeah. Right.
Well, you probably right. I wouldn't just.
I don't know if I'm right.
No. But I had never. I think of him as this, and then I'll answer, and then you pick it up.
I'm just worried about the use of the word simple.
Right. I didn't mean.
He means him, and I don't think that's.
I didn't mean simple in.
Unencumbered.
I didn't mean simple in a non-intellectual way. I think of it as something totally focused on one thing when I say that. And you were going to say, and both of you ladies had something to say.
You just gave me. No. I was just thinking about it.
No, I was just thinking unencumbered. Brilliancy is often perceived as simple because the ability to grasp very complex things very quickly and easily, and to be able to portray them or show them to someone And that's in terms of definition of simple. Some people perceive that they do it so easily.
Yeah, I mean, it's simple, I mean pure, simple in terms of a rather pure kind of.
What I want to say is the purity and innocence in Mozart. No.
Ah, yeah, that's very interesting. Yeah.
Say it again. I'm sorry, I didn't hear it clearly.
Purity and innocence in Mozart is what she was saying, and she related to that in terms of Ionesco.
I was going to mention that the word simple, I come from Israel, and the word simple in Hebrew means whole, complete, totally whole, completed, and that's how it's being used, so I don't see it.
Okay.
I like that. I like that very much. I've learned something. That's great. I can learn a lot of things, please. But I never thought of it that way because I don't know Hebrew. But I think that's fantastic. Whole.
Even
it means whole.
Noah in the Bible, the one who's supposed to be a righteous man, is quoted as Noah was a simple, simple righteous man. And even in
Japan.
When you want to, in big talks and meetings like that, if something is over, the meeting is completed, the meeting is done, you use the word simple. Tam? So, where I come from, it's the same thing, only a different aspect of it.
One of the things about that is my husband Phil always told me he's Tom.
He is.
I remember when we first were dating, and I was going with friends that are very political, and they had opinions about this, and opinions about that, and opinions about this, and some of them were about things that I thought Phil would know something about, and I have a tendency that I have to join in and argue about anything. That's who I am. And so I asked Phil later, "What did you have any opinions on what they said?" And he said, yes. And I said, why didn't you say something? And he said, they didn't really want to know anything. They weren't asking questions. And I have a feeling that Ionesco was making a joke of the kind of gathering that we get to where everybody gives their opinion, but they're not really listening to each other.
He's giving a reflection of the way he sees reality.
Yes.
And that's his reflection, that's his mimesis, his copying or imitating the reality. And whatever we want to take out of it, we can any ism that we want to take out of it is fine.
Yeah.
But he's showing it. But the greatness that I see in Ionesco is the witty, he's very witty.
Oh, of course.
The wittiness of his dialogues.
Yeah.
They're wonderful. One thing came to my mind in Rhinoceros. I saw it when I was 16, so many, many years ago.
Which and one?
Rhinoceros.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not sure. Rhinoceros.
Yes, you did. No,
by the way, in Tel Aviv, Ionesco is being played constantly.
Really?
Till as we're speaking, constantly. So, anyway, so when I was in high school, when I saw Rhinoceros, and there's one thing that stuck in my mind in the dialogue there, that one of them is turning into a rhinoceros, and he wants to talk about something else, and I can't remember what. And his friend is saying to him, wait a minute, you have a pimple on your nose. Oh no, that's because I have a rash, no problem. And he continues talking about something else. Wait a minute, you have hair growing out here. Oh no, it's not me. No, that's nothing, that's just shade. And they keep going on, and the guy is turning into a rhinoceros, but he doesn't admit it. And that's the first thing that stuck into my mind. Ionesco portrayed it so beautifully as a joke.
Yeah.
It was a joke.
Yeah.
But it's not a joke.
No, but that's the quality of much
of
his work.
There's
this sort of dialogue.
It's not what he said, but how he said it. Mm-hmm. How the dialogues are so short and quick.
But also, I think the sardonic quality in it, you know, is very in your face, and it's great, you know.
I'd like to add something else.
Yes,
please. Somebody asked for synopsis.
Yes.
I
know.
The play, The Chairs.
Oh, yeah.
What is the synopsis? A couple of old people are setting up their house looking like this. Just a living room with chairs because supposedly they're going, they're expecting a great speaker to come. And the entire play, I think it's one act, I'm not sure.
Yes, it is.
The entire play, they're discussing the chairs, and they're discussing how, to which angle you could hear the speaker much better, and the audience is listening, and they want, it's getting build up to hear that wonderful speaker. And then the speaker comes, and he opens his mouth, and he goes, and he's totally dumb. He can't speak. And that's the end of the play. And that kept me. And how many times in life we see that? Every day I see those things going on.
You may see it next Monday.
I have to reread all of Ionesco's work now. A lot of it's gone out of my head since these years, you know.
But you go through life and you say, oh, that's a very interesting situation. It reminds me of Ionesco's something.
Here's another wonderful quote from it that applies to everything everybody's been saying. Escape from definitions and you will breathe again. Escape from definitions and you will breathe again.
Breathe again. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what Ionesco, that's one of my favorite quotes of his. I need to work that into this talk. I need to redo this talk and add to it now because of this. Which is great. I mean, I'm delighted to do that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming.
Sorry, I had a